Before we learn how this is magnesium chlorate, or that iron 3 bicarbonate is drawn like this, let's start with the basics of naming ionic compounds. An ion is an atom or molecule that lost or gained an electron and now has a charge. Cation has plus in the name for a positive ion. Anion, an, means without, for a negative ion. Together, a cation and anion give me an ionic compound, where plus and minus gives me neutral. We'll look at metals and nonmetals, transition metals, and polyatomic ions, starting simple with sodium and chlorine. First, we find them on the periodic table. In my periodic table video, you learned that here we have the metals, the nonmetals, and transition metals. We won't go into the complexities here because what we care about is how to find the charges. From the left, you get plus 1, plus 2, and plus 3. We skip the transition metals because those don't follow a pattern. And then from the right, we go negative 0, minus 1, minus 2, minus 3. From the table, we see sodium is plus 1 and Cl minus 1. Bring them together and we get NaCl. Is the compound neutral? The net charge must be 0. Plus 1 minus 1 equals 0. Yep. When naming, a metal keeps the name. That gives me sodium, calcium, potassium, and a nonmetal gets the ending IDE. For example, oxygen becomes oxide, chlorine is chloride, bromine is bromide. Sodium and chlorine would give me sodium chloride. What if the charges are not the same? For example, calcium and bromine. Calcium is plus 2, bromine is minus 1. If I put them together, I get plus 2 minus 1 for a net charge of plus 1. But ionic compounds have to be neutral, so how do I get 0? Since calcium is plus 2, I need two negatives to balance. That gives me plus 2 and minus 1 times 2. Plus 2 minus 2 equals 0. To show that I'm using two bromides, I need a subscript 2 for CaBr2. How do we name it? Metal keeps its name for calcium. The nonmetal gets an IDE for bromide, giving me calcium bromide. What if both have complex charges? For example, aluminum and oxygen. Aluminum is plus 3 and oxygen is minus 2. We can do it the long way, figuring out how many pluses and how many minuses gives me a total. Oh my goodness, that takes too long. Or use the criss-cross method. It's as simple as it sounds. You just crisscross. You bring the charge from your cation as the subscript for the anion, and then reverse. That means aluminum gets a subscript 2 because oxygen was negative 2, and oxygen gets a subscript 3 because aluminum is plus 3. That's 2 aluminum with a charge of plus 3, and 3 oxygen with a charge of minus 2, giving me plus 6 minus 6 for a net charge of 0. For an ionic compound, Al2O3, aluminum oxide. Transition metals are tricky because they don't follow an easy-to-memorize charge pattern. In fact, they can have more than one charge. Iron can exist as plus 2 and plus 3. So how do you know which ones to use? There are two clues to look out for. If you're given a name, the transition metal will have a Roman numeral telling you the charge of that metal. Notice that iron 2 oxide has a 2 in parentheses, telling me that it's the Fe2+ ion, not 3. And since I know that oxide is minus 2 and they both have the same charge, we write iron 2 oxide as FeO. You can also do the crisscross method. I get Fe2O2. But with ionic compounds, it's not one atom to one atom. It's hundreds of atoms in that ratio. And so we always use the lowest possible number. In this case, divide them both by 2 and we get FeO. But scientists didn't want to make this so easy, so they also came up with special names. Fe2+ is ferrous, and Fe3+ is ferric. Here's how I think of it. Since ick is more than is, I think ick, I ate too much charge in this case, for the higher charge. This works even with other charges. Cu+ is cupris, and Cu2+ has more charge, so it should be ick, cupric. What does ferric oxide look like? Ick is the higher charge, that's Fe3+ and O2-. The crisscross gives me a 2 for iron and 3 for oxygen for Fe2O3. If you're given the formula for a transition metal, just balance the charge. Actually, just reverse the crisscross. Given SnCl4, Sn is a post-transition metal, chlorine is minus 1, reverse crisscross, but tin doesn't have a number. Actually, it has an invisible 1. We already know that chlorine is minus 1, and now we know tin is plus 4, which gives me tin 4 chloride. What about PbI2? That's lead, a post-transition metal, and iodine minus 1. Draw the invisible 1. Reverse crisscross, we know that iodine is minus 1, and now we see that lead is plus 2, giving me lead 2 iodide. What if your ion has more than one atom in it? As the name implies, we have poly, or many, atoms that together make up an ion. Many atoms together have a single charge. For example, OH minus, the hydroxide ion, is not an oxygen attached to a negative hydrogen. Instead, it's an OH together with a negative charge over the entire thing. If needed, formal charge in organic chemistry helps you find exactly where the charges come from. The good news, you just use the polyatomic ion as the name in your organic compound. The bad news, you kinda have to memorize them. But don't worry, I've got you covered. Just comment cheat sheet below for my polyatomic ions cheat sheet. What is the ionic compound made from sodium and hydroxide? We see that sodium is plus 1. We memorized hydroxide as OH minus. Na plus and OH minus have a plus 1 and minus 1 that cancel, giving me NaOH. What about calcium and nitrate? We see that calcium is plus 2. Nitrate you have to memorize as NO3 minus. Since the charges are not the same, we have to crisscross. Bring the 2 down to the nitrate, the 1 down to the calcium. That's CaNO3. Do I just put the 2 here? No, because that would be 3 times 2 for 6 oxygen. But what about the nitrogen? For a polyatomic ion, you have to put the entire thing in parentheses and then put a subscript after, telling you that everything in the parentheses is multiplied by that number. That's 2 nitrogen, 2 times 3 for 6 oxygen, and a net charge that's neutral. Even though you memorize them, some of the polyatomic ions are so similar, for example, SO4 and SO3, both with a minus 2, that they're very easily confused. Do you remember Ic for more positive? Here we'll use 8 for the one that ate more oxygen, and ite for the one that is a bit light in oxygen, giving me sulfate for more oxygen and sulfite for the one that's light in oxygen. If PO3 3- is phosphite, or light in oxygen, when I add one more for PO4 3-, I get phosphate, because it ate one more. One more tricky one. If ClO3 is chlorate, it's the one that ate an extra oxygen. One less, ClO2- should be chlorite. What if I take away one more oxygen for ClO-? Now it's hypo, even less. Think hypoglycemia for low blood sugar, or hypothermia for low temperature or very cold. What if I add one more oxygen to chlorate so it overate? That's perchlorate, and I think of perchlorate, we get more oxygen. With this in mind, can you draw magnesium chlorate? We see that magnesium is plus 2, and you've memorized that chlorate is ClO3-. Crisscross the charges, giving you 1 magnesium and 2 chlorates. That's Mg, open parentheses, ClO3, close parentheses, and then a 2 for the entire chlorate. Let's try a transition metal and a polyatomic, iron 3 bicarbonate. We know that iron is Fe, and we're given 3 for plus 3. You'll have memorized bicarbonate as HCO3-. The crisscross gives me 1 iron and 3 bicarbonates for Fe, open parentheses, HCO3, close parentheses, and another 3. For even more on ionic compounds, visit my website, layerforsci.com/ionic.